they like to be in my place instead of me, cause nobody go crazy when I'm banging.
Move into the Elantra. Thank you, Tom. So this is the 2007 Elantra. We first showed it at the New York Auto Show earlier this year, so many of you may remember seeing the car, seeing images of the car. A car we can all feel good about right now is the kind of the tagline that we may use for our advertising, although that hasn't been completely decided. I'll be taking feedback from you all on that throughout the day. Key selling points for this car for us: unsurpassed standard safety. Again, that's a key part of our menu. Expressive exterior and interior design, along with America's best warranty. So any of the products we've launched in the last 24 months, we can say these things. It's the glue that kind of binds all the new Hyundais together. But they all have unsurpassed standard safety technologies in their class. For the Elantra, 6 standard airbags, standard ABS with EBD, with four-wheel disc brakes, when a lot of cars in this segment still have rear drum brakes, and standard anti-active front head restraints. Those are the anti-whiplash head restraints that, in a rear-end collision, cradle your neck. Roomiest interior in its class. It's so roomy, actually, it's classified as a midsize car. And I love these little comparisons, but more interior room than an Acura TL. That's surprising, and when you get in that car, you will notice that room and appreciate that room, especially in the back seat. Premium comfort and convenience features: leather seats, which you won't find on Civic or Corolla, heated seats, not available on a Civic or Corolla, and beginning at the end of October, standard XM satellite radio. So all of the Sonatas and Santa Fes we're building right now have standard XM satellite radio. We began production a couple of weeks ago in Alabama. Elantra and Azera are the next cars that we're rolling out this standard XM satellite radio as well. So, and that comes with 3 months of service. And then the America's Best Warranty. Key competitors, here are the Corolla, Honda Civic, the Nissan Sentra, and the Mazda 3 are really the key competitive targets for Elantra. Just from an image standpoint, we've gone, I think, from a fairly conservative family appearance, as we say, with the old Elantra, to a more sophisticated, personal, certainly more expressive design with this new Elantra. It has a lot of the new evolving Hyundai design language. Very strong, distinctive headlamps. The hood has perhaps not quite as bold as the Tiburon, but it does have some sculpture to it. Very strong, lower air intake. In side view, you get a sense for the sculpture line, which you're seeing on more and more Hyundai products. So I'm talking about this line here, which kind of has a Coke bottle profile. You see that on Santa Fe. You'll also see it on the new Veracruz. And that's a bit of a signature that's coming out of our California design studio. All of those products really had their genesis in California. 16-inch Euroflange alloy wheels. Those are standard on the SE and Limited models. Nice-looking, simple 5-spoke wheel. In general, sculptural surface quality. We talk about practical sculpture as a design language element for a lot of the new Hyundai products. There's the XM satellite radio antenna. We always work for a strong stance, meaning a very wide track given the width of the body, and large expressive lamps. Inside the car, I think this is where the Elantra really distinguishes itself from the competition. The interior is very, very high level of quality and craftsmanship. Leather-wrapped wheel and shift knob, metallic accents. It's two-tone. Steering wheel-mounted controls. You can see the blue interior lighting here as well. So typically pure blue in the center stack. And in the cluster, you'll see a combination of blue, often with white numbers and letters. Three different interior colors: beige, black, and gray, with leather available. Very roomy from on the interior, and this is total interior volume, right? So these are the combined interior cabin space plus trunk space. That's how the EPA classifies cars. Cars over 110 cubic feet are considered mid-sized cars. So Nissan's new Sentra, which they launched, ends up also just fitting into this mid-size category. Corolla at 103.9, substantially smaller car inside. And remarkably, the Honda Civic actually got smaller on the inside from the prior generation to the new generation, although it does look like a bigger car. It's a great-looking car, but it did compromise interior spaciousness. Focus does pretty well from an interior space efficiency standpoint with its European roots. But Cobalt, very, very space inefficient, actually categorized as a subcompact, the Chevy Cobalt. And you feel it when you're inside that car. So we like to make this comparison, Elantra more interior volume than the new Sentra, but also even more than the Acura TL. And again, you'll notice that. You'll feel that inside the car. You don't have, no. Unlike the Nissan Sentra, we're not making you live in the car for a week. But I do think that's a great campaign. So how did we do that? Well, we did grow the car. It got about 2 inches taller. We raised the driver's seating position, the so-called H-point, 1.8 inches. That opens up lots of room inside the cabin, lets the rear seat passengers get their feet under the front seat, for example, lots of other things that really add to the sense of spaciousness. So you can see we ended up here. We are a little shorter and a little lower than the Sentra, but we've got more room inside the car. That's package efficiency. Lots of standard convenience features, standard power windows, power door locks, remote keyless entry, heated dual power mirrors, standard, multi-adjustable driver's seat, this rear center armrest with cup holders and a 60-40 split fold-down rear seat back. That's Brandon. Brandon Ramirez insisted that those be standard equipment on the Elantra. One of our findings from the owners of the prior Elantra, one of the shortcomings of the car was lack of interior oddment space, storage space. So maybe we overcompensated a little bit, but they're all kinds. We take this negative feedback to heart. And so you've got upper dash storage, overhead sunglass storage, dual level storage compartment in the armrest, console storage box and ashtray, a little storage tray here, front mat pockets. Oh, there are more. Dual front cup holders, seat back pockets. We mentioned the rear cup holders. There's a strap holder on the side of the center stack and an illuminated glove box. A couple of different audio systems, 172-watt AM/FM, XM CD MP3 audio system with equalizers and 6 speakers. And then there's an upgrade on top of that with 220 watts and a separate amplifier. All of our audio systems, beginning with this October, late October production, will have standard XM satellite radio on the Elantra. Again, 3 months of free trial XM satellite radio service. We've also got our first Bluetooth connectivity available probably in the fourth quarter. And I believe we have a car, we have one car with the Bluetooth connectivity. So if you've got a Bluetooth phone, you can give that a try. Okay, and for the first time in a Hyundai, an iPod input jack. I know you guys are saying it's about time. You guys are supposed to be on top of things. This is our first one, and we'll be rolling this across all of our products, hopefully by the end of next year. We would like to have them in every car by 2008 model year start. So we have some optional features as well, leather seating surfaces. Which are standard on the Limited. Heated front seats, optional on the SE. Even with a cloth seat, you can get heat, and standard on the Limited. We have a nice power sunroof. Getting back to safety, I like to make the competitive comparisons on safety. In a car like this, there really is a certain responsibility for side impact airbag protection, because with the SUVs and pickup trucks on the road, you really need to do everything you can to protect your customers in side impact collisions. So we offer the seat-mounted side impact airbags, side curtain airbags protecting the first and second row, ABS and EBD, four-wheel disc brakes, and active front head restraints. What's amazing to me, again, there are no, it's a drum brake segment. I find this amazing. All of the key competitors are rear drum brake.
Side airbags only up front?
The seat-mounted side airbags are just up front, and then the roof rail-mounted side air curtains are front and back. Yeah.
What about the ESC? Is that available on the Elantra?
ESC is not available on the Elantra. But when it is available in a compact sedan, you will find it in a Hyundai first. You'll notice a lot of automakers have talked a lot about ESC and when they're going to have ESC on their vehicles. Have you noticed that? So GM says they're going to have it on everything by 2010. And then you look at their lineup now, and it's on hardly anything. And Ford says, oh, we're going to have it on anything by 2009, but you look at their lineup now and it's pretty much just on SUVs. It would be very easy for me to say when we're going to have all of our ESC on our products in the future, and it's going to be at all those guys. But if it's not available now, what's the point of talking about it? A customer can't buy a 2009 Ford Fusion or a 2010 Chevy Cobalt. So we just choose not to talk about, you know, these future dates of when we're going to have ESC. We choose rather to say, it's on 73% of our cars right now, no one can beat that, and we're going to lead in every segment in which we compete with that technology.
Is there a reason why you didn't make it an option on these?
Yeah, the issue with optional safety equipment is it won't be ordered consistently by dealers, it won't be ordered consistently by customers. It just seems to be kind of a, you know, it's just not the right way to do it. When you're going to do it, you need to jump in and make the equipment standard. It's just a philosophical point of view. No, and that can be part of it, but there are other brands out there that offer ESC as optional. You'll find it. And then I would challenge you to go and actually try and get one of those vehicles, and you'll find you can't. They're not stocked by dealers. You have to special order it, and 6 months later, you might actually get the car. So our approach is, one, we're ready to launch the technology, and we can offer it at a price that assures that there's still going to be a lot of people wanting to buy that car who can afford to buy the car, then we'll go ahead and offer it.
In other words, the ABS with the electronic brake force distribution. Are those the same components that are used for your...
It's a subset. You need, there are a lot.
I know you need more. I just mean, in many cases, you have to go to a faster solenoid system.
Yeah.
On the thing. And I'm just wondering if this is the fast enough solenoid system to just add the other things to it.
The key bits that you use are the wheel speed sensors. Yeah, but you don't have the yaw sensor. You don't have the steering wheel sensor. You don't have the...
It's just adding yaw sensor and adding computer power.
Yeah. Yaw sensor, steering wheel sensor, more computer power, and sometimes a pump. Sometimes another pump. So you talked about standard ABS with EBD. The brakes, foundation brake system has been increased in size. I think it's up about 0.4 inch, we said, Brandon, 0.4 inch increase in rotor size. So there's more brake capacity, more thermal capacity. Front seat active head restraints. So these are these things in the event of a rear collision, the headrest moves forward to cradle the neck and protect your neck from going rearward. Latch, 3-point seat belts for all seating positions, front seat belt pre-tensioners, these shingle style front or rear head restraints, so that when there's no one sitting in the car, you can push the head restraints out of the way. And then lots of just good engineering built into the car, front and rear crumple zones, body side reinforcements, designated trigger points called hood buckling creases, an energy-absorbing steering column. Now, the powertrain is our familiar 2-liter four-cylinder engine. This is not the global engine design shared with Daimler Chrysler and Mitsubishi. This is a refinement of the existing 2-liter four-cylinder. It comes in two very low-emission variants. One is ultra-low-emission vehicle. The other is partial zero-emission vehicle technology. We'll be selling that car in California. It's cast iron block, aluminum head, 16-valve, continuously variable valve timing on the intake side. It has hydraulic motor mounts, and you'll notice those today. And does very well for fuel economy, 28 city and 36 highway. If you compare to the old model, it's 4 miles per gallon better. But yet it's the same engine. And you saw how much bigger the car got. But what's amazing, and I always like to talk about weight as an indication of how strong your engineering team is, this car is 60 pounds? 60 pounds lighter than the Elantra it replaced. 60 pounds lighter. That's amazing. So that 60-pound lighter weight helped us reduce the emission test weight class, right? We made other improvements in the engine, reducing idle speed, which gave us about a quarter of a mile per gallon. Improvements to the ECU and the calibration gave us another half mile per gallon, reducing internal engine friction with optimization on the piston rings. Improving transmission efficiency, another quarter of a mile per gallon. Improvements to the K factor, the efficiency of the torque converter, over a half mile per gallon. The impact of the improvement in the emission test weight class. It's the first Hyundai with a motor-driven power steering system. That's worth 0.68 miles per gallon. Electric power steering, yeah. I believe it's pure electric. There's no hydraulic aspect to it. Hydraulics are all gone. Improvements in tire rolling resistance and driveline efficiency. So that's how you can make a huge improvement in fuel economy with what is essentially carryover engine architecture. Now, there are hundreds of changes inside that engine. There are lots of changes in the vehicle. Even though the vehicle's larger, it is lighter, and all those things add up to a real significant fuel economy improvement. Two different transmissions, 5-speed manual in the base car and 4-speed automatic. You'll have the opportunity to drive both of those today. And we think when you put it all together, it stacks up reasonably well versus the segment. Maybe the closest competitor is the Sentra. Sentra puts out a little more horsepower, a little more torque. It's a couple of miles per gallon short on the highway fuel economy side, and it weighs about 100 pounds more than we do. Corolla is just a 1.8-liter car, as is the Civic. So they do a little bit better on fuel economy. They come up a little bit short on horsepower in the Corolla's case, and torque for both of them. And then you can see the comparisons with the Focus, fairly similar numbers to the Focus, and the Cobalt's a 2.2-liter car. Interesting point about the Cobalt. You saw a subcompact interior. It's not very roomy. It's a very heavy car, 3,200 pounds. So they've had to use a much larger engine, and that impacts their fuel economy. 118 mph top speed. We've started, by the way, publishing our top speed information. Did everyone hear about the Sonata rental car? Listen, I think Auto Week did a little back pages story on it, but this guy was speeding in there was a Sonata V6 rental car that he had, and he was late for something, and he was tracked at 147 miles per hour on radar, and his defense was, it couldn't possibly have gone that fast, it's a Hyundai Sonata. We didn't appreciate that, so... We confirmed the top speed was 147, 148 on our test track, and let the guy know. And I think Auto Week put a little thing in the back pages saying, "Don't call Hyundai as your lawyer." That's good. That was real good.
Some lawyer named Hyundai now is probably
gonna. Irving, there you go. So just a little bit on the chassis. It's our first motor-driven power steering system. You'll find it's very quiet. We worked with TRW. This is a TRW design. They helped us tune this system with our U.S. Dynamics team based out of Irvine and working in our Mojave Desert Proving Ground. It has a very different and specific to U.S. market tuning. the Korean domestic market tuning. Interesting how different national tastes are on steering. The Korean car has very low effort, almost no parking lot effort. Our efforts are quite light, but if you were to drive the Korean car back to back with this car, you'd see just a significant difference. McPherson strut up front, and rear suspension is independent multi-link. With a rear bar that's up significantly, we had a very small 12 millimeter bar on the old car. That's now a 17 millimeter bar. Two-wheel and tire combinations. The base is a 15-inch T-speed rated 195, 65, 15 with a full-wheel cover. The SE and the Limited gets this really nice 16-inch alloy wheel. It's another one of those Euroflange designs, right? With an H-speed rating and a 205, 55 size. More body stiffness data for you. We're up 49% from the outgoing model. Corolla was our primary benchmark. We're up 9% over the Corolla. And you can see some of the data here. Very quiet car. You'll notice this when you're driving it. We measure it as 2 decibels quieter than the Honda Civic at highway speeds.
Has the Elantra been crash tested yet?
No, not yet. Not yet. And it's really up to the government as to when they crash test. But
do you have any projections as to how it
do? Do we have projections, Brandon?
If the front is a 5-star, mm-hmm. then the side is a 5 to 4. 5?
Yeah, so it's all our own internal testing. Projects 5-star up front and 4 to 5 for side, something like that. There's always error band around the side impact testing in particular. So 3 different models. GLS is our volume model. And then we've got the sporty variant called the SE and a more luxurious model called the Limited. Apologies for the eye test here. Most of the volume is in this GLS with the preferred package. That one model will probably represent about 40 to 50% of our total mix. The SE is, and we have a lot of SEs here, is very similar to that car, but adds the alloy wheels, steering wheel audio controls, and a telescoping steering wheel. So very, very similar car. And then the Limited really just adds leather chrome rear garnish to the SE. So very simple mix, very few build combinations.
Uh-huh. On the other chart, you had manual automatic breakdown.
Yeah.
I don't see it on this chart.
Yeah, so here... Manual available, just about every flavor, automatic.
The chart had a percentage.
You're saying the mix.
Oh, the mix. Yeah. Do we know the manual automatic
the manual
mix?
Manual total mix of 13%.
13% manual?
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks.
This pricing I'm 100% confident of because we've actually sold some cars, so we had to have the pricing done. The all-new model is 670 under the outgoing model. We have added a model without air conditioning as a base car, and that's one of the reasons why the starting price is lower. This is similar to what Honda does with the Civic DX.
Yes.
The Civic DX is a very basic model that doesn't have air conditioning or audio system, etc.
Yeah, it's a comes in at some incredibly low prices.
Various automakers have strategies like that one. That's really not our focus model. Our dealers have asked us for that car, and believe it or not, there are some markets where they really don't want air conditioning, you know. So we build a lot of those cars anyway for Canada.
What's shipping?
Shipping is $600. And all these prices were with shipping, right? Let me check. Yes. Everything with shipping. So here's a comparison. And this, remember I mentioned that car, the GLS with the automatic and the preferred package. That's a really typically equipped car, right? It's got automatic, air conditioning, great audio system, power everything. You're really not missing anything. That's priced at $16,500. The Sentra S model and their CVT starts at $17,065 with freight. But then you have to add ABS, cruise control, and by the time you're done, you're at $2,300 price difference. comparing it to the Corolla. Corolla will be the most cross-shop car versus Elantra, there's no question. We weren't disappointed when Toyota delayed the launch of the new Corolla, quite frankly. So, you know, base-to-base, comparably equipped car, there's about a $400 difference, but when you add the safety equipment, the side impact airbags, head curtain airbags, ABS, and cruise control as part of some other option package, you end up with about a $1,500 price difference. Comparing it to a Civic, Civic is one of the hottest cars in the industry right now. The average Civic is selling for over $19,000 transaction. Honda has a home run on their hands with that car. But you can see there's a substantial price difference between Elantra and Civic LX. Honda's done a good job with standard safety equipment. They include most of it. I think everything except the active head restraints?
Everything except the four-wheel disc brakes.
So they've done a good job. About a $2,000 difference with the Honda. Here's our color palette. We were talking about colors last night at my table at dinner, and I was mentioning how color is one of the few areas where, you know, the team has an unfettered opportunity to express themselves, and that is with the color name. So we came up with this very controversial color name, Purple Rain. Do we have a Purple Rain car? Yeah, so you'll be able to judge whether or not that color was worthy of the Prince album of the same name, right? We also have Black Pearl for you Pirates of the Caribbean fans. So in terms of buyer demographics, we're looking at a 40% male, so 60% female owner group. Average age, younger from the, comparing to the current Elantra, we expect this car to skew a little more female, a little younger, a little higher household income. A little more college grad, and again, fairly similar to the compact segment profile. This is the average of all domestic and import compact segment cars.
Will you keep your fleet sales rate about the same with the new car?
We hardly have any Elantra fleet. I mean, maybe if we, I'd be surprised if we did 2,000 cars this year. So very little fleet, and yeah, we would keep the same plan. In terms of sales history, we just provided this for your reference so you could get a sense for where Elantra has been running. It was our first vehicle to sell 1 million units in the U.S. We reached that level last year in 2005. And we decided that Sonata would reach that level probably next year, right? We say that Sonata would reach 1 million next year. 116,000 sales in 2005. We're looking at a similar number, maybe a little bit less in 06. Honestly, this year we ran out of Elantras, just as we ran out of Accents. We had a strike in the summer. There has been so much global demand for our four-cylinder powertrain capacity that we've been really short at with all of our four-cylinder products, including Accent and Elantra. And we're concerned that next year could be a similar situation where our sales could be constrained by capacity as they were this year. No. I mean, from a capacity standpoint, possibly.
In other words, you have an assembly line. Yeah. That's making, you know, you want a few cast iron block, you know, boards left, you know, in that market.
Mitsubishi Evo. Evo 10. Okay. Cast iron block as well. It's in good company.
They don't know. They have no money.
what are you shooting for in 07?
First full year sales target, 100,000 units. Yeah.
So what? So $16,000 from...
Brandon, where do we think we're going to come out for 06? Don't have that handy? Let us get you the 06 data. It might be 105 or 110 or something like that. I think it's again more a function of this is the time of year where we're negotiating our sales levels for next year, and I feel confident we can get enough cars to sell 100,000 next year. You know, if we can get more cars, we could probably sell more cars. So this car started production in August. It is on sale now. We've just had our first retail sales the last couple of weeks, actually. So you'll start seeing these on the road soon. It started production in August, and I think we had our first retail sales last week, maybe the week before. So they're just now showing up at dealerships. National TV marketing campaign is beginning in January, and since you've all been so good, I think we can show you that ad. Right, I just have to say I had nothing. So if you didn't like this ad, I have nothing to do with this ad, but just always like to show you what we've got.